Okay, so how many of you are Avengers fans? Only in Rupal? Okay. Okay. So, the main villain of Avengers, Thanos. So he has a purpose in the movie. For those who are not aware, the villain is Thanos, and his intention is of his main aim is to wipe out half of the universe. But it is not an idea which he is doing out of evil intent. He has the logic behind it that the resources are limited in the universe. So we are still limited to the world, our Earth. He's looking at a bigger picture, imaginary probably, that in the whole universe, the resources are all limited. And we are consuming the resources day to day to such an extent that we are going to exhaust them very soon. So he thinks that the solution for continuing of existence of all living creatures is to wipe out half, so that the remaining resources will be enough for the half population which is left. So this was Thanos' idea. But the fact which we need to understand from this fictionary story is that yes, the resources are limited, and that we are consuming all of them at an enormous rate, and the number of years left ahead for us is reducing if we continue to do what we are doing today, if we continue to exhaust the resources in the same way which we are today. So many of us have the intention to do something, to do our role, to contribute towards the environment. But the knowledge of how to do it, how can I contribute, is lacking. So we do our small steps.
This Gucci's method can produce 20 kg of ready-to-eat rice by a single village woman in 5 to 6 hours of day's work. Materials required, mix.
Okay, so we want to do our share. Yeah. We want to do our share, but we do not know exactly how we can contribute. So this is a chart to show you that how much our food has an imprint on the ecosystem. So probably a phone we buy once in 3 or 4 years. Car we buy once in 10 years, 15 years. House, it's almost for us usually once in a lifetime or twice in a lifetime. It is a thing which we do. But food, every single living human being, organism, 365 days in a year, 3 times minimum in a day, is consuming something that is food. So if this consumable is environmentally sustainable, if this is eco-friendly, then we will be doing a large role, we will be playing a large role in doing something to save the environment for the future generations to come. So this is a pictorial representation of how important the food is in the eco footprint. The small lines say, eco skyline of the inhabitants of the city of New York for the year 2000, with building height related to the environmental impact as quantified by the ecological footprint analysis. So this is community activity, short. Air travel, very small. So car, and this is not sure. So food packaging, domestic gas, electricity, housing, many other things. But food stands the tallest. So we usually seem to forget that food has a big impact on the environment. We'll remove this. Yeah, close it. So one of the resources which we are running out of very soon is, people say that the next world war is going to be fought over water. So in terms of one, we will see a comparison of the different foods which we consume. So if you are consuming 1 kg of rice, it has taken 8,000 liters of water to reach your table. It takes 10 to 12,000 liters of water for 1 kg of wheat to reach your table. 27,000 liters of water for 1 kg of sugar to be on your table. 45,000 liters of water for 1 kg of meat to be produced and reach your table. But when we come on the other hand to millets, it hardly takes 200 to 300 liters of water. So just for the sake of a small calculation, let us see how much we 30 people have saved water in these 3 days. Okay? So 30 people, 3 days into 3 meals, 270 meals. Okay? Suppose all of us were consuming, let's leave out this and just take rice. Suppose we all were eating the minimum, after Siridhanya, the next minimum, let's say, is rice, and we all were consuming rice. So 1 kg of rice is going to feed 4 people. Am I correct? 4 meals from 1 kg of rice, approximately we can have 4 meals. So for 4 meals, we have 8,000 liters of water. On the other hand, now we have had millet meals. So 1 kg of millet rice, if you are eating well, it will have 8 meals. Even a smaller, lesser consumption would give up to 10 meals. But let's say that we are all eating it very well and have a huge appetite, and only 8 meals can be made from 1 kg of millet. So 8 meals, we are using only 300 liters of water. So in order to calculate, in rice, it would be 2000 liters of water for 1 meal, and in millets, it would be 300 divided by 8. 400 by 2, 200, no, sorry, I'm wrong. Okay. 38 liters for one meal. So into 270. Please help me with the calculations. 2000 into 270 is 5 liters of water. But we have instead used 38 into 270, which is
10,260.
So how much water have we saved? Okay, let's for approximation say 5,30,000 liters of water just in 3 days. Now imagine if each person does this for even a year, how much water we would be saving. This is just in terms of water, one of the resources. But we can calculate this in terms of the amount of land which is needed. We'll do another small calculation. So if there is 45,000 liters of water which you are using to produce 1 kg of meat, please tell me how many people will consume 1 kg of meat for a meal, suppose? 6?
6 to 10.
If they are mainly eating protein as their meal.
6 to 10.
Okay. 2, okay. So let's keep an average of 6. 6 meals. With the same 45,000 liters of water, I can grow divided by 300. So 150 kgs of millet. You give me the same 45,000 liters of water, instead of using it to produce meat, if you give it to me, I will produce millets. So 150 kgs of millets into 8. I can produce 1200 meals out of the same water. So now you see how much impact our food is having. We are measuring in terms of water on the environment. So if I am able to even convince 10 people in this room to switch over to a millet-based diet, I will be satisfied today that I have done my role for the environment. And the more I do it, the more happy I feel. So if there is one reason why I want to spread the message to people to eat Siridhanya, of course, the health is one factor, but my top priority would be the environmental factor which is involved in the food which we are eating.
Capacity of RMP. It's around 15 acres of land per year. Is around 20 lakh liters of water. Right? You can actually pay, take a walk and see a big pond there. So that going by this, right? If we have conducting this program with rice, I think we consume so much water in just a couple of days. Yesterday we were going for this fall and we saw that the entire capacity is just 20 lakh liters. And also there was a small calculation done. So if you just eat millets per month, we'll be saving 10 lakh liters per family. 10 lakh liters means half a pond of water we'll be saving per family just eating millets.
Multiply it with the Indian population now.
Yes,
1.3 billion people. Okay. So we look at a little more statistics. This is all data which is collected from 2005 to 2015, not the most recent statistics. So there might be a little change in this, but what is available will work with that. So 400,000 hectares of agricultural land in India is being used to grow tobacco. 600,000 hectares is being used to grow tea. 850,000 acres is being used to grow coffee. So coffee and tea need a cool climate. So we cut all the forest in the Western Ghats for coffee and all the forest in the Himalayan mountainous regions, and we have mountains. Like if we stand at one place, we can see 5, 6, 7 layers of mountains, and the entire mountain ranges have been cleared of the forest area and it has been converted either into a coffee estate or into tea estate. And think, how much for sugar cane? 5 million hectares is being used just to cultivate sugar cane. Are any of these substances something which is essential for living? No. This much altogether is being used just to feed our addictions. Nothing good. We already saw the amount of sugar we need is zero. What else is sugar cane used for? Alcohol. So coffee, tea, alcohol and tobacco, all our addictions. We are wasting so much of our resources, so much of our fertile land just to feed our addictions. So this is how our habits have an impact on the environment. We look into small things for the environment, but we seem to be forgetting the bigger picture. We seem to be forgetting the major contributions, what is going to have an impact on the environment. Isn't it sad, just for our addictions, how much land we are wasting? And what is happening after growing all this? We are again becoming unhealthy. It's not that it is helping us in any way. We are addicted to it and it is again making us diseased. We are not thinking in a bigger picture. We are restricting our vision to certain fields only. This is what is the problem. So since we are playing the number game, a little more numbers to impress upon you. World population is around 7.7 billion. Yes.
Perspective on that. When you say 200 to 300 per million, it's actually not the cultivable water resource we are using, not from any dam and all. It's just rain fed.
Yes, exactly.
If you actually calculate, it's absolutely nothing.
Yes.
The kind of investment you are doing to build a dam and do the irrigation facility, all there you need to count the water as 8K to.
You need to multiply it more. Yes.
For the rice, but here for millets, it's absolutely nothing.
Yes.
It is rain fed.
Exactly. We'll come to that in the agricultural aspect. So there are, on any given day, approximately 100 billion chicken on this planet. 7.7 billion humans. And please help me with the statistics.
3,000 tigers?
No, no, no. The
100 billion chicken. 9 billion pigs.
Okay. So, pigs should be million or billion?
9 billion.
Chicken was a bird which was rarely found in the forest. If there were 100 peacocks, you would find in the forest one or two chicken. That's how rare a bird it used to be in a natural setup. But for our greed, we have now made 100 billion chicken. We grow them in all unnatural, unhealthy, unhuman conditions. And now there are 100 billion chicken on the planet at any given moment. The same way we have 12 billion cows, 9 billion pigs, and the human population just keeps exploding. And we use all the resources present on the earth as if it was meant only for us and no other living creature. I think Surya was mentioning in the introduction session, Indian culture, we usually start sessions with the saying of Sarve Janaha Sukhino Bhavantu. What does this mean? It is not only let all people be happy. Janaha means every organism which has taken life. Janam is birth. So every organism, including microorganisms and all the other organisms which are around us, should be happy. This was our culture. But where are we today? There are hardly, if this is represented in bars, we need to represent in dots. What? There are just 3,000 tigers left in the entire world. There are hardly 1,200 panda bears left. Such cute creatures. We adore them when we look at them, but there are hardly 1,200 left. Whales, there's a specific type of whale called the right whale. They are being hunted year after year just as a sport. There are hardly 450 of them left. These are those which are still surviving. But there are so many more which have already entered the extinct species. Even plants are becoming extinct, many species of plants, and the endangered list just keeps growing every day. So what has happened to all of them? We have swallowed all the resources, we have cut all the forests, we have depleted them of their homes, we have deprived them of their homes and converted all this living into just a few selected species which we want and which we need and which we have considered as our food. So this is the statistics. This is the situation in which we are today. Isn't it true that the earth's resources was meant for equally for them? But now they are hardly surviving, struggling to exist. Of course.
So mostly caged and in human
conditions. Yes. Exactly, that is true.
There is a, on the YouTube, there is a documentary called Earthlings. Earthlings, yeah. If interested people can go through it. I dare you see with open eyes till the end of the video without crying. I mean, if you do that, please let me know.
Yeah. So now moving on to the agricultural aspect. We spoke about hectares of land being wasted, but then now moving on, what a farmer can do. So what is the situation today is, because of many so-called scientific myths which we already mentioned, we have eliminated the use of the things which a small farmer can use. For example, the general notion is that red wine is good for you because it gives health to your heart, because it contains a substance called resveratrol. This is greatly being publicized. You can have a glass of wine a day. It is good for you because of the resveratrol which is present in it. Resveratrol is good, of course. It has anti-aging antibacterial anti-inflammatory all these good effects. But what no one is telling you is there is 20 times more resveratrol in our locally available, easily growable food, nothing but our peanuts, groundnut. The pink husk which is there in the groundnut has 20 times more resveratrol than your red wine. But no one tells you eat the peanuts, eat a fistful of peanuts. No one tells you that. They would rather say eat cashew nut or eat badam, which again is a crop which is more sourced from outside. But they don't tell you to eat your local foods. They spread the fact, so-called fact, that there is aflatoxin present in groundnut oil. So if you extract oil from groundnut, you are going to get poisoned with aflatoxin. Yes, this is partly true if it is grown in, if it is stored and not handled properly, if there is moisture, there is a tendency for fungus to grow. That is true with all substances. If you don't handle it properly, if you don't take care of crops properly, there is a chance of fungus attacking. But that word is used and groundnut oil is completely eliminated. Coconut, which people used to use a lot in Kerala and coastal regions. People say there is too much cholesterol in it. Do not use coconut. But Sunday ho ya Monday, roz khao ande. Is there not cholesterol in egg? Of course, there is much more cholesterol in egg. So in this way, the locally available foods which a farmer could grow, which were equally or even more healthy, are being completely wiped out just for the commercial purposes of promoting certain products which can be manufactured centrally, processed foods and sold to you at a much higher rate. So even alcohol, we send the sugarcane from India at such a cheap rate and then buy alcohol from outside which is double, triple, four times the rate. So we are giving our local produce and buying something at a much higher rate. So this is how the mafia of food works. Eliminate the local foods. Eliminate the usage of curd. So in India, every household used to use curd. But then there are rumors spread that usage of curd makes you fat, or curd is not good for you because it gives shita tendency, it makes you cold. Then they spread that and then bring in the calcium supplements into the market. So in this way, slowly, day by day, local foods have been eliminated, which were good for our health for commercial purposes. And thus a farmer who could grow his own food and who could grow and sell to people locally producible food is now having to grow some cash crop and having to sell that, and he himself, being a farmer, is depending on the market for his own food. The farmer is the only one who can be independent if he wants to be and not depend on anyone, because he can produce his own food. But that ability to a farmer has been withdrawn from him. He is also becoming dependent on the companies, on the market, to buy even his own food. So why is this happening? As we already saw, there is in India, agriculture has been the mainstay occupation. So in this agricultural land, only two-third of it is directly dependent only on the rains for the water. Only one-third has irrigation. Out of this one-third, two-third is dependent on borewells for the irrigation, hardly one-third. So totally one-third of the one-third of agricultural land has canal irrigation being given. And in all this canal irrigated land, we are either growing rice, wheat or sugarcane. This is what is happening, which is a very small portion. All the remaining farmers are depending on either borewells or on the rain. And we all know how erratic the rains have become now, totally unpredictable. Borewells have dried up to an extent that we have to dig deeper and deeper and deeper, and yet we are not getting water. And also the same story when it comes to rivers. Rivers which were perennial have become seasonal. Rivers which were seasonal have become non-existent. When we are traveling on the road, we have bridges which are around 500 meters wide, say. It was built 500 meters just 10 years ago because the river was of that width. But now we have a small stream of hardly 100 meters flowing, and all the rest of the bridge is like on the land, which was supposed to be over the water. This is the state of our rivers. The main streams, the rivers, huge rivers have now become hardly visible streams. Waterfalls, there is no water falling in the waterfalls. Any tourist place we go, we are disappointed because there is no water to see there. So in this situation, there are so many farmers who have 1 acre land, 2 acre land, just 3 acres of land, and who do not know what they can do without water. They do not know what they can grow. So if all of us are going to depend on locally producible foods without being water intensive crops, for example, siridhanya, they hardly need 200 to 300 liters of water, which is going to be sufficient if there are 4 rains are sufficient for us to grow siridhanya. Even less than ragi, even less than jowar, these are drought resistant dry land crops.
What is siridhanya?
The 5 millets, the 5 positive millets. Yes, the 5 positive millets, we refer to them as siridhanya. So these can be grown with just 200 to 300 liters of water. And the most beautiful thing is, it just takes 70 days for harvesting brown top millet, 90 days for harvesting foxtail, little millet and barnyard, and 120 days for kodo millet, which brown top is the most costly because the demand is so high and the supply is very less. It was almost eliminated, so we are still in the process of making it easily available. So in just 70, 90 or 120 days, you can produce these millets with just 200 to 300 liters of water. So a farmer can produce easily two crops in a year, one in the rainy season, and if he has mechanisms in place to retain the water through simple techniques like trenches and bunds and collecting the water, he will be able to take a second crop as well. So within a year, they can harvest two crops. In 1 acre, without any investment into it, easily without doing any extra procedures, you can easily get 6 quintals of millets can be produced. If you put in some efforts along with mixed cropping and along with certain methods to improve the soil fertility by increasing the microbial content, you will easily be able to get 10 to 12 quintals just from 1 acre. So a farmer, 1 quintal is, so easily a farmer who has just 1 to 2 acres of land can get 3 to 4 lakh rupees in a year easily without having to do any investment from his side. And all they need is 2 or 3 rains in one crop cycle. And then next comes the problem of, okay, let's not just concentrate only on Siridhanya. I'm also speaking about the, we already saw about the oils, how oils extraction from the garni process can lead to rural employment. For that, they will also have to grow the locally producible oil seeds. These can also be grown without much water. And when you do a mixed cropping method where you're growing dicotyledons, 20 to 30%, 60% of the main grain, that is the Siridhanya, and 10% of the oiling things, you have a mixed cropping system which will prevent pest attack also. So you can naturally avoid the chemicals and produce all the requirements within one crop. It is going to be symbiotic with each other. So the dicotyledons produce the, they have the capacity to fix nitrogen, and they are going to give the required fertilizer for the crops other than the dicots. So then the question comes up, what does the farmer do with what he has produced? Does he again have to go to the middlemen and sell it to them and lose out on the price? So now in the market we have brown top available at 350, 400 rupees. But the farmer is hardly getting 60, 70 rupees per kg when he is growing it. For the other millets, he gets hardly 30, 40 rupees, and yet here we are paying 150, 200 rupees. So is it possible for the farmer himself to process it and add value to it and directly sell it to the consumer instead of depending on middlemen? So this was the question which came up, and then we decided that if we have to depend on machines, big machines, then the farmer is going to lose out. So we developed some small techniques in which the farmer himself could process it, and the whole family as such, if the men are working in the fields, the women can work with the produce and convert it into either rice, flour or rava and directly sell it to the consumers. So the method adapted for this was the Bucci method, and I think you will be seeing a video which will be self-explanatory, and I will explain later if you require.
Here, go.
Namaste. Processing of Siridhanya through Dr. Kadar's Mucci's method. Modern agricultural practices have systematically destroyed our traditional food habits and our practices both in agriculture and cultural domains. The negative impact of water, fertilizers, pesticides, intense practices of heavy machinery in modern day's world has steadily caused damage both to the health of flora, fauna and environment as a whole. So to undo the damage done, Dr. Kadar has thought and executed on various aspects, brought the attention of the public to our traditional grains and named them as Siridhanya, that is, foxtail millet, little millet, kodo millet, barnyard millet, and brown top millet. Growing Siridhanya is relatively very easy. Even any poor farmer can grow these wonderful grains in barren land with 4 to 5 rains or with very little water. Growing them in large quantities is also easy, but to dehusk and make rice ready to eat has been again a task that required machine, making farmers to depend upon technology and huge investments. So to make this task easy and farmer friendly, Bucci's method is designed by Dr. Kadar to demystify the centralized processing and distance heavy machine technology of dehusking Siridhanya with the use of simple mixing. Special instrument is retooled by Sri Balan. So let us stop worrying and learn simple steps to process Siridhanya at home with no extra cost or trouble. Olden days it used to be mortar and pestle, which is very labor oriented and time consuming. This Bucci's method can produce 20 kg of ready to eat rice by a single village woman in 5 to 6 hours of day's work. Materials required: mixie, sieve, earlier it used to do ragi cleaner, and winnower, that is in Kannada, mura. Step 1. Get the grain cleaned for dust, stones, etc. Soak the preferred grain in water for 5 to 6 hours. Collect the immature grains that float on water and discard them. Dry under sun for a full day, preferably on a karpa stone platform. Step 2. Fill 1/3 of the mixie jar and operate mixie in pulse mode for 20 times approximately. Empty the jar contents in the sieve. While one performs sieving, the coarse or muchu, broken grain, falls off the sieve. Check for fine mud of same size in the broken grain. Use mara to remove that. Collect and store muchu separately. Step 3. The unhusked grains get aggregated on the top of sieve. Collect this every time and repeat the pulse action in mixie again. Step 4. What is left in the sieve is the full grain. Collect and store in separate container. Last step 5. Repeat step 2, 3 and 4. One person can thus obtain approximately 20 kgs of finished grain in a day in this fashion. Thus, by Dr. Kadar's Bucci process, with the help of 4 to 5 village women working for 7 hours, can yield 250 kgs of Siridhanya ready to eat. Thank you. Namaste.
Aging of the rice is also important for getting better yield when you process it. At least 6 months if you keep it. It's the same with any paddy rice as well, I think. So the more the age, up to 2 years, it gives better quality of rice. So once that is done, we soak the grain. It becomes easier for removing the outer husk when it is first soaked and then dried well. So I think you heard, preferably on a stone. So the heat, it comes from below as well. If you put it on a cement surface, the underside surface is not heated. But a stone surface, the heat is from above and from below. So the drying takes place in a much better way. And then the mixie is just a little tweaked. The RPM is reduced and the blades are slightly made blunt. You don't use the sharp blade, make sure that the blade is a little blunt and the RPM is reduced. It's not rotating at a very fast speed. So you just need to do the pulse action. You don't turn it on 1, 2, 3 mode, opposite direction. Just the pulse action 20 to 30 times. And then, of course, the sieving and the winnowing to separate those which have not been separated yet. Yes, some will break. So that we sell as rava. Or you can make that into flour. The whole grain is present. Even the husk is being used as fodder. So there is no wastage in the entire process. Everything which is there is going to be useful. The amount of rava is actually very less compared to when you produce in a machine. You put it into a big machine. Polishing is more, first thing. You are losing the outer good lignin material, and the amount of production of rava is also more when you use the big machines. So you just have to separate it and all the substances are usable. So in this way, and even this, what all is required is a little bit of power source, and that now we are trying to make it into a small low cost solar panel so that the villagers don't even have to depend. In villages, they don't have current for most of the day, hardly 3 hours or 4 hours in a day. Many villages have electricity connection. So since that shouldn't be a hindrance, and since, of course, solar energy is a renewable source of energy, we are trying to devise low-cost solar panels so that the village ladies can sit and do their work. They can sit under the tree and have the solar panel under the sun and finish the work. So what I am trying to convey here is, if we are using Siridhanya, if we are using locally produced substances which are also good for our health, we are not only benefiting our own health, we are helping the money, instead of going to the multinational companies, is going to reach our villages. And along with the oils and along with the food, there are also few other substances like tooth powder. I think all of you have been using tooth powder. We can also have other things which women can do at handicraft, things like the wooden comb, which are useful for us also and which will help give them employment, empower women in the village.
What, so wooden comb?
Wooden comb. I think it was there here yesterday. Searching for it. So we all know that when we comb our hair, in science experiment we would have done in school as children, to produce static electricity, we rub the plastic comb against our hair, and then it has the capacity to lift small pieces of paper. So this electrostatic energy is also one of the main responsible factors for hair fall. When we are combing our hair with such a comb, it is going to pull out our hair and make the hair follicles weak. So a simple solution would be to use wooden combs. It is good for us and it will be giving employment to the women.
How is this made?
Handicraft, sir. Wooden comb.
But somebody should give the,
yes,
procedure.
We'll show it in the afternoon session.
Huh?
We'll show it in the afternoon session so that
We were also looking for we found out that toothpaste is not ideal to use. It has sugar, it has chemicals, and it is causing harm. But then we need to clean our teeth. So what is the alternative? So we suggested, of course, neem stick, stick from Pongemia, stick from Meswak, stick from Babool, all these are good. And along with that, there is charcoal powder, activated charcoal powder, which has been an age-old practice which was used to clean our teeth. I think you have been doing it from the past 3 days. So how is this made? It is usually made from waste coconut shells. No big investment required. Just used coconut shells. They have to be ignited and burnt slowly. And the process of burning has to be stopped before it converts into ash by adding water. Then it is dried. So you have activated charcoal ready, powder it into a fine powder. And then we usually add salt, lavanga, neem, any other herbs which are known to be good for oral hygiene. So what does activated charcoal do is, Since it has a large surface area, it helps to adsorb the microbes inside the mouth, and it also adsorbs bad odors as well. I think you will have seen the advertisements which are coming up, even in facial creams they are using activated charcoal. It helps to pull out the dust. So it has been an age-old practice in our country to use activated charcoal as an agent for cleaning our mouth. So in this way, we can train certain villagers to produce this in a small-scale industry, cottage industry type. So there are various products which we use on a daily basis. Say, instead of the commercially available soaps, we can have handmade soaps, or we can have even more natural bath powders which they can produce. So in this way, our daily requirements, which we are spending on a large amount of money, which is going to the companies, will rather go to the villages and help the village to develop on an overall basis. Okay. One more topic I forgot to mention here is about global warming. I think everyone is aware that we are already seeing the effects. Till recently, most people were in denial that global warming is happening, but now we are not able to deny it, because everywhere the temperature has already risen by 2 to 3 degrees centigrade. So if this continues, in this situation already, with a 2 to 3 degree raise in temperature, there is a fall in the yields of rice, wheat by already 20 to 30%, because of the global warming which is happening. And if this raises by 2 more degrees centigrade, which is likely to happen in the next 10 years, the yield is going to become less than half of what it already is. So this is because they are C3 foods. Rice and wheat are C3 foods. In plants, you can divide them into C3 plants and C4 plants. It is based on the way they arrange carbon to form glucose. So C6H12O6 is glucose. So if they join 2-3 carbon units to form glucose, it is called a C3 food. Most of the plants which we see around us are C3 foods, but there are a few plants which have evolved and become C4 foods. This is nothing. One of the main examples of this is our Siridhanya. So what is the difference happening is, at higher temperature, what plants do is, they have stomata to breathe. Plants also need to breathe. So they have small pores in their leaves which help them to breathe. So at higher temperatures, plants close their stomata so that the water which is present in them does not evaporate. They want to retain the water. So during this process, what happens when the stomata get closed, the plant cannot breathe in a normal way. So as a result of the photosynthesis reaction, we had oxygen also being produced inside the leaf. This is a photosynthetic reaction. Oxygen was being produced. So a plant normally has to give out this oxygen from the stomata. But because of the raise in temperature, the stomata are closed and the concentration of oxygen is increasing inside the leaf. When the concentration of oxygen increases, the substances which were supposed to use carbon dioxide by attaching to it and converting it into glucose now get attached to oxygen. So because they are attaching to oxygen and not to carbon dioxide, this process becomes slow. So this is the reason why the yields of rice and wheat have reduced. They are not able to produce glucose at higher temperatures because they are C3 foods, and the oxygen concentration increases inside the stomata when the temperatures are higher. So they are not able to fix the carbon dioxide and make it into glucose. But what happens in C4 foods is that they have evolved into special drought resistant foods, which even in spite of higher temperatures, in spite of the oxygen concentration increasing inside the leaf, they have a new mechanism developed where they can fix the carbon dioxide and continue to produce glucose. So even if the temperature rises by 2 more degrees, the yields of millet, Siridhanya, will only increase and not reduce. So the optimum temperature of production of Siridhanya is more than what it is right now. Now, I'm not saying that global warming should happen. Of course, it's going to be a problem in every other way. But in the future, if the global warming continues, the world will be forced to depend on millets for their food, and not because they want to, but because rice and wheat will not be, we will not be able to produce it anymore at all. So why wait for that situation to occur? So you will all be the pioneers. That time people will be coming to you and saying, okay, you have been using millets since long back. We have to use it now because there is no rice and wheat available. This is the situation which will arise if global warming continues the way it is. So what I mean to say is our millets are drought resistant as well, and they are C4 foods, which are specially evolved kind of plants which are drought resistant. So because of this nature, we are trying to use C4 plants, Siridhanya, to convert barren lands into fertile soils. So even in the mining areas, where mining destroys the soil to the maximum extent, even in such regions, we have been able to regenerate the soil using microbial concoction and by growing Siridhanya and being able to convert it again into fertile lands. It's been done on an experimental level, yet to be reproduced on a larger scale to convert all the mining wasteland into again fertile lands. We are conducting experiments on sandy soil, desert soil, because the resources needed for growing Siridhanya are so less, the water needed is so less, the fertility needed is so less. Even in sandy soil, with a little effort, we are able to grow Siridhanya, and then slowly, as the process continues, the sandy soil can again be converted into fertile, growable lands. So if you're growing rice and wheat, the land fertility is reducing. Year by year, the amount of fertilizers you'll have to add is only increasing in order to keep the soil alive. But on the other hand, if we are growing Siridhanya, even barren lands are being converted into fertile lands. So I think we have enough reasons to convert into eating millets. Not just our health, it involves the environmental aspect, it involves the economic aspect of helping the rural development and all around development of our society. So I think I have given enough reasons for all of you to take the step and change. Okay, we'll stop here for today. Any doubts regarding this?
How to start cultivation now? Suppose I want to cultivate it.
Yes.
How to start?
Nothing much to be done. Just a simple superficial plowing of the land. As I said, mixed cropping is ideal. The only problem is birds love it.
Oh, we have that.
Yes, you produce nets, you told me yesterday.
Yeah, actually, we are conducting a program called Sardar Krishi. Already the work has been done, wherein it has been teaching has been done in the local languages, that is Kannada and Telugu. Now we are in the process of preparing the literature and the substance to be given out in English language. Once, as soon as that is done, we will be letting you know, and you can come and that program and get the knowledge of how to cultivate.
Yeah, that's important.
Not very difficult, very easy actually. Yeah.
How is the watering then done? Or how is the,
don't
you do any watering?
If it's rainy season, it's not required. Otherwise, sprinklers once in a week is sufficient.
Birds can spoil this.
Birds love it. So if you don't protect your crop, there will be hundreds, thousands of birds which just come like a blanket. Half day they devour the entire crop and almost nothing is left for you.
Make a feast.
Yes, they feast on it. But it is a pleasure to watch as well. So
sprinkling water we have to take from the bore well, no?
Yes, that is very little. Very little compared to any other crop. And the best part is when the birds leave, they have left their droppings behind, which makes your soil much more fertile for the next crop and is going to multiply your yields. So first 2-3 times, if your land is not yet fertile, just allow the birds to eat. We leave one area just for the birds. So they also are required, they also have to eat, and they have been deprived of their favorite food. So when we grow it,
it is a bait for them.
Yes. So when one farmer is growing it, you feel it is a loss because all the birds only use one crop. But if more people are growing it, it's being done in a larger area, the loss because of birds will not be much. And we can't call it a loss because they're helping make the land so much more. Yes, and in their droppings come many more seeds. Not just the fertilizer, the seeds which they have carried from distant places. So it helps new trees to grow in your area, which would not grow if you plant them on your own. But because they have come through the droppings, you have the local species of trees also developing in the area.
But and first one or two crops we have to go in there?
Not necessarily. That is what we do, because we want the whole ecosystem to develop, not just for our gain only. So as a model, we have a farm in near Mysore where people can come see, and who want to farm can also learn how to farm, but those who just want to have the experience and see a ecological model can visit as well.
Seed cost?
Seed cost is around the 30 to 50 rupees per kg. You'll need
1 acre, for 1 acre land you can get it in
5,000 to 6,000 rupees. So 1 acre it is only 4.5 kilos of seed. Seeds are enough for 1 kilo, in 1 acre of land.
Three and a half.
How much is 1 acre? How much?
43,000 square feet.
43,000 square feet. Actually, you know, answer that in terms of, since we are from Mumbai, the numbers, approximate investment cost would be around 5,000, right? You know, as an investment by the farmer. And if you are from, you know, southern states, the government is giving a 6,000 advance in cash.
Everything back.
No, to grow millets, they're giving 6,000 as an investment in the government. Correct. Okay, right. And a couple of other things that you also asked, you know, as part of Kade Krishi, we'll be learning how to harvest water. So there is a water, you know, conservation, you know, mechanisms that we'll be employing in the fields. So we don't need to actually draw from the wells. We would be conserving, and that water is more than enough to cultivate, you know, the crop. Right, we do pits, and we make sure that water doesn't percolate below, and we store that water to spray.
How you get back the water?
Sorry?
How you get back the water?
From pump it back.
Pump it back. Means you don't give the water at all. Take it back. After spilling.
Harvested water will be pumped back. First day when it comes, the crop will get the water. For the second cultivation, the water that has been harvested will be used for the second cultivation, not the first cultivation. First cultivation it will be.
But how can I harvest it? By pump?
No.
There is
pits.
Some store.
There are pits.
It's percolate.
There are multiple ways, sir. Obviously you need a, you know, pump and all, but if it is a small pump, you can draw it and then sprinkle it, you know, there are cost effective ways, and
sprinkling is all right first time. Then what you say, the next time you harvest the water, how you harvest the water?
Water harvesting is done through pits. You
have to make pits.
Pits, and you know, pits in such a way that, you know, the water goes into that pit when it rains and then gets stored.
Collect.
It doesn't get evaporated. We take measures for the next crop.
Rainwater.
Yes, rain.
So during rainy season, you don't need to put anything. It will grow on its own. But when after
second season,
you want to put a second crop, that water can be used.
But throughout the year, you can get the crop?
Two times. We don't need to produce this, but to be frank, because we won't be able to eat. There is an estimate that if we cultivate in Indian agriculture land, if we cut millets, we would be able to serve entire world with one or two crops. So we don't need to really cultivate throughout the year.
No. How many crop you can get in a year?
Two.
What two is the crop. Best season to sow?
These are best answered as part of Kadukrishi.
I think that will be an entirely different subject and topic on growing it. So,
just to answer the question though, you prepare your farm based on the arrival of grains and you sow it according to the duration that, when the crop even comes in, you there should not be any more rain so that, you can process the grains and
dry it.
So let's say you are putting something which comes for 4 months, then you start accordingly. So that after the end of 4 months, you should not have rain. If it is, let's say, the crop is only for 2 months, but you get rains for 3 months, you wait for a month of rain, and then you sow it, so that after 70 days, you don't have any more rain, and then you can harvest.
You know, how many days the crop is ready?
So we already covered that, sir. 70 days, 90 days, and 100 days based on
cover is ready.
Correct.
Crop is ready.
Ready
so
for harvest.
We'll stop there. I think that's a 2-day program. We'll be going. We'll be pushing you guys. We'll go there and learn it.
Yes, curiosity.
It's,
I don't know farming. But
yeah.
I was asking.
It's better to learn it on the field than inside a room. Yes.
I have to tell to the guys. No?
Yes,
see
of course.
How we can come up.
Yes. During harvest, there should not be too much of rain, but otherwise it can be grown even in regions which receive a lot of rain. It's not a problem. Just the time is what is important. There are methods, like we don't want the water to stand, we want it to percolate into the soil. So there are farming methods so that we can use the water and recharge, but not allow it to stand constantly, and we don't want it to be like standing water for rice. So if there is more rain, we have methods to make it flow and get collected rather than stand there. Okay, so we'll stop for now.
What about that?
Being a woman, I think I will concentrate on women's problems for now. Okay, so just a 10-minute topic, not even 10 minutes. So,
I just wanted to say one thing, even in my feedback form, I said that we will be using millets more and but today after this topic, now we are, actually I am really shaken from inside. That we have to actually use millet not for our health, but the betterment of this world, what we are giving to our children, like what we got is
yes.
already in this condition.
Yes.
But we actually have to start using it anyhow, whatever, but we have to.
I'm happy I was able to touch one person at least in this rest. This is our, I can say, ulterior motive, but to reach people, even the health aspect is what touches most people first, but then it leads into all the other aspects as well. Yes, thank you. Okay, so another small topic which I was keeping for later, but let's finish it now since we have time, about how to clean our vegetables and fruits. So it's not practically possible today to get organic vegetables and fruits everywhere. We have not been able to do it. It's not yet available to such an extent that as soon as we wish for it, we get organic fruits and vegetables. So in order to reduce the toxic load from the vegetables which we get from the market, there is a simple method of soaking it in tamarind water for 10 to 15 minutes. So the tartaric acid which is present in tamarind water helps to extract partially the chemicals which have been used to grow the pesticides and the chemicals which have been used to grow the fruits or vegetables, and then washing it thoroughly with our copper treated water will help you to reduce the toxic load. So instead of direct, if you get organic vegetables, fruits, well and good, but if you do not, you can protect yourself reducing the toxic load by this procedure. You need a lemon sized piece of tamarind, soak it in water, allow it to become soft, then squeeze all the juice out. That will be enough for a bowl full of water. Put all your vegetables, fruits which you are using for that day in the water, leave it for 10 to 15 minutes, wash it properly and use it. This will help.
Imli,
yes. Yeah, dried imli jo rehta na, kitchen mein what we use. Soak it in water for 10 minutes, it will become soft, squeeze out all the juice, and in that juice, just soak your vegetables and fruits, fresh vegetables and fruits.
Yeah.
So in the morning, if you make this ready and keep, you can utilize it for the entire day. It can be done. Okay. So we need to give solutions for the existing problems. So this is a simple way to reduce the chemical load.
Mom, you'll be covering the other parts also.
Earthen pots also. Everything in this small duration is difficult. I all think I already mentioned that for cooking, steel is good, and other than that, earthen pots are good. Nonstick we already saw is a form of plastic, and it is entering our digestive system. So after 6 months, you will not get the same effect with a nonstick tawa which you got on the first day. So, huh? Iron is we use for kadai, frying, such things. On a regular basis for cooking, steel is ideal. And not aluminium. Please avoid aluminium vessels. Lot of people are in the habit of using aluminium. I already said copper also is not good for cooking. It is only for cleansing water. Aluminium is toxic to the kidneys. It is a main cause of constipation. It also acts on the bone marrow and reduces your blood counts. So using aluminium for cooking is not good. Ideal is mud pots, of course, and it also has the aspect of again helping a person who is making the pots. And it is aerated. The food inside it gets oxygen. So especially to make ganji, you have to use earth pots. The taste of food is much, much more when you cook it in earthen pots.
What about glass and brass vessels?
Glass is okay, but you cannot cook it in.
You can store it.
Yeah, you can store. Yes. What is available now, the purity of it is questionable, and to polish it, they again use chemicals, so it is better to be avoided. And they use some amount of lead also in it to, yes, so better to avoid. Okay, so we'll wind up for now. Again, 2:30 we will start.